When I gave my life to the Lord, I was a stripper, and I made a decision to completely change my life. I had no idea where to go to church, what to do, how to dress, and one day I was sitting out at a coffee shop, and some girls were walking around, and they were telling everybody about their church. Well, I was so excited. I thought, this is going to be it. This is going to tell me where I can go. Maybe they'll be my friends, and instead, they took one look at me and the way I was dressed and how I looked and gave me a dirty look and passed me over.
I was going into fourth grade, and that summer my parents sat me down and told me that they were getting a divorce. And I remember being blown away by that. And then on top of that, we showed up at church over the next few weeks, and I just remember feeling this difference there, that we weren't supposed to be there. Like, you know, we had divorce slapped around our chest. And for me, it made me feel like there was something wrong with me.
I trusted Christ when I was in high school. Decided to go to Bible college so I could figure out some of the answers to my questions as far as the Bible and God and making that work practically. During my senior year, I really felt like instead of getting answers and getting help with some of my questions, I got rejected, in so much as even the college president calling me out in one of the classes and basically saying, if you just, you know, if you still have questions this late in the game, you just don't get it.
I grew up in a church for 20 years, and when I went to college, I made a few mistakes and got pregnant out of wedlock. I knew there would be trouble, I knew there would be gossip, but I never expected a phone call from the pastor asking me to resign my membership.
Well, for the first time in my life, I was really coming back to God. I was trying to really reconnect with Him, and my life was a mess. I was going through a divorce, I was in debt, I didn't have any friends, and so I actually wrote a letter to a friend of mine that I knew from high school. I knew that she was a pretty strong Christian, and I thought maybe we could start up a friendship. So I sent her a letter, and a couple weeks later, I got a package back in the mail, and I opened it up, and there was no letter. It was just a pamphlet on why divorce is a sin.
Well, I struggled with same-sex attraction all my life, and being a Christian and brought up in a Christian home, Christian school, I had difficulties dealing with it, and went to my pastor because I knew there was some kind of issue with me and I had some problems, and instead of receiving spiritual guidance, I received, hatred. And I was condemned, and I was asked to leave the church.
There came a point in my marriage where things got really rocky. I made a decision to trust the people at the church and start telling them about what was happening. And I expected them to try and understand. I expected them to help, to accept us broken like we were, but instead they judged us, they judged me, they blamed me. It was definitely not okay to not be okay.
I was 5 years old. I was going to Sunday school, and I seen a statue of Jesus, and I knew my grandmother would really like it, so I took it from the church and gave it to my grandmother. The next Sunday, whenever I went back to church, the preacher took me aside and told me I was going to go to hell for stealing. And it really scared me, and that really turned me off. And I asked my mom if I had to go to church anymore, and she said not if I didn't want to. So I stayed away from church for 31 years. And I pretty much went to hell for the next 31 years.
It made me feel rejected.
I was totally crushed.
To this day, it affects my family.
What good did that do anybody?
God forgave me, but the church couldn't.
I wish He would have treated me like a brother instead of a piece of garbage.
We need to be examples and not tell people what they have to do or what they should do, but just show them what we do.
Bow in a word of prayer. Father, I just thank You so much that You love us the way we are. Help us, Lord, to see others with the heart of Jesus. Help us to see them the way You see them. Father, help us to reach out and touch them with the love You have for them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The story of a man who went to a very crowded airport, and he was getting a flight. And he went and bought some cookies that he was going to take home for his kids. And so he sat down, and it was a very busy place, and he put his jacket and his cookies down in the chair beside him, and lo and behold, there was this person coming toward him, this young man. And when he looked at the young man, he knew that he was just a teenage punk. He had long hair, rings in his ears and his nose and his lip, tattoos all over his body. And he couldn't believe that he was going to sit right next to him. And he sat down, and the man looked away, and out of the corner of his eye, he could see him eating his cookies. And he turned, and sure enough, the man had the bag, and he had a cookie. And he ripped the bag from his hands, and he took a cookie and put it back down beside him and turned away again. Couldn't believe the audacity of this punk. Turned around again, and there he's eating his cookies again. So he ripped it out of his hand again, and he took another cookie to show that they were his cookies, and he put them back down again. Couldn't believe this guy. And a third time it happened. Looked around, and sure enough, that guy's got the bag of cookies again. And he ripped it from his hands and took the last one and ate it and crumpled up the bag and threw it on his coat. And the young man just gave him this big, huge smile and walked away. Couldn't believe this guy. Well, his flight was actually called, and so he reaches down and grabs his jacket, and underneath his jacket was his bag of cookies. Sometimes we judge people very quickly by what we see on the outside. But this young man had shown total grace and acceptance of him. We often really quickly jump to conclusions. When I first started teaching, I was out of school and teaching grade 8, and I had been warned when I was hired that there was going to be some difficult kids in this class, and I wasn't quite ready for what I had that year. But there was two guys in particular who were really, really tough. One guy actually almost hit me with a calculator one day when he threw it at the chalkboard and just missed my head teaching math class. These guys were tough, and I didn't know what to do with them, to be quite honest. And I watched this little film called The Greatest American Teacher. And this teacher was a person in the States, a teacher in the States who was working with inner city youth. And he talked about how what he did is every day he would come to school early and he would sit in the desks of the students and pray for them. Well, I thought, well, I got nothing to lose. It can't hurt, that's for sure. And so I started coming to school early, and I would actually go to the desk, and I would sit down, and I started praying for my students, and praying not so much that God would change their life, but that God would change my eyes to see them the way God saw them. Well, I could tell you how things changed that year, but it was amazing to me looking back how much God had worked, not just in them, but in me, changing the way I approached teaching. And changing the fact that I needed to adjust my eyes to focus more on what God was seeing and not what I wanted to see. And it was amazing how the one guy in particular, how God touched his life. 2 years later, I was at a totally different school in a totally different town. I got a call from one of these guys. And he invited me back to his profession of faith and wanted me to come spend time with his family for lunch. Last year, and this is like 17 years later, he called me up again while he was passing through Caledonia. He looked me up in the phone book and said, I'm passing through town, just wanted to know if you want to go for a coffee. God works in amazing ways. As a matter of fact, I've actually considered using that as a discipline of technique in my classroom. I thought it would be quite effective. The idea is that, you know, after you talk to the kid two or three times and you keep telling him to sit down, you finally say, hey, listen, Johnny, you don't understand. The more you misbehave, the more I'm going to be praying for you. And you don't want to be messing around with the awesome God that I serve, let me tell you. But I don't think that would work so well in the public school system. But the fact is, it's true. The more I pray, the more God works in my heart. And the more God works in their hearts. And I've seen that already at McKinnon. Things that I could tell you that were amazing of the students that I've prayed for. And how God has changed my relationship with them and allowed them to touch my life as well. And that's what we have to do. We have to look from beyond the outside to the inside and have the heart that Christ would have. What kind of heart does Christ have? Well, if you look at John 13:34-35, it says, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. And 1 John 4:8 says, whoever does not love does not know God because God is love. Well, how did Christ practice that kind of love? Well, I'm going to take you through some stories, starting with Luke chapter 19, 1 to 10. How about those who have it all? Those who are, in our eyes, rich and successful. You know the people we sometimes love to hate. We find them arrogant and selfish and self-absorbed. Why? Well, because usually they have exactly what we want. And they've accomplished what we wish we could. And they seem to have no worries in life at all. And they can buy anything that we would wish for. And so we find them untouchable. Well, Jesus, when he's going through in Luke chapter 19, it's starting at verse 1, says this: Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was very wealthy, or wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but by being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." Zacchaeus had it all. He was rich. He was not just a tax collector, he was the chief tax collector, which means he just didn't get money from the people, he got money from the other tax collectors as well. He was probably despised not just by the people around him, but by the people that worked for him, because he would have what they could not, and he'd be taking what they felt that they had earned. He was loaded and hated. But Jesus knew he was still looking for something. He got up in that tree because he wanted something he didn't have yet. He saw that there was something internal missing, something he couldn't buy on this earth. I wonder if it's possible that we get wrapped up sometimes in the things of this earth and we find ourselves envious and jealous, so much so that we miss seeing other people with the eyes that Christ would want us to see them with. Jesus saw a desire in Zacchaeus for something more. The encounter with Jesus resulted in an eternal focus and a changed sense of value. He now had a desire to store up treasures in heaven and not just on earth. Well, how about those people who are sick and rejected and hurting? In Luke chapter 5, we see an encounter with someone just like that. It says in verse 12, "While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, 'Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean.' Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. 'I am willing,' he said, 'be clean.' And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered him, 'Don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them.' Yet the news about him spread all the more, so that the crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses." Jesus saw a man that was covered with leprosy. If you want to see what leprosy looks like, it's not pretty. This person would have the triple whammy against them. They were sick and dying, and possibly later on going to lose body parts. They were physically unattractive, and they had been declared unclean, because anyone who would touch them would also be declared unclean and rejected by society. Yet Jesus looked beyond the physical. He looked beyond the sick and the dying. He looked beyond the physically unattractive. He looked beyond the fact that this man was unclean and rejected, and he saw someone needing love and compassion as well as physical healing. So what he did is he reached out and touched him, showed him love and acceptance. He touched them despite having the risk of contracting leprosy himself. And he touched them despite the fact that he could be declared unclean by the people around him. He touched them because he saw something deeper, that this man needed to be shown that he was cared for, that he was accepted, that he was loved by an awesome God. Well, how about those with poor reputations or a low sense of value? We take a look at Luke chapter 7, starting at verse 36. And it says this, "Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. And as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, 'If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner.' Jesus answered him, 'Simon, I have something to tell you.' 'Tell me, teacher,' he said. 'Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more?' Simon replied, 'I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled.' 'You have judged correctly,' Jesus said. Then he returned toward the woman and said to Simon, 'Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water from my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little.' But Jesus said to her, 'Your sins are forgiven.' The other guests began to say among themselves, 'Who is this who even forgives sins?' And Jesus said to the woman, 'Your faith has saved you. Go in peace.'" The woman was probably a prostitute, and she came in exactly the way she was. She didn't pretend to be something she wasn't. Jesus saw her and her needs, and he was touched by them. So he risked his reputation. He let her touch him. But he sees the need that she had, the feeling of unworthiness that she had, and in the end encouraged her so much by making her look better than Simon, the actual Pharisee that he was visiting. He compares her to him, and she comes out on top. There's a story about a man who was walking along, exploring caves along the water. And in one of the caves, he finds this old bag of clay balls. And he finds this kind of funny and strange and finds them kind of useless. So what he starts doing is he takes the bag with him and he starts walking along the water and he throws them one at a time as far as he can, over and over again. He gets down to the last few balls in the bag and he goes to bring one out of the bag and it falls and breaks on the ground. And he realizes that when he opens it up that there is a beautiful jewel inside. And it's to his shock and amazement, he breaks open the last few that he has, and sure enough, in every single clay ball was a beautiful jewel. And in one sense, he's amazed and feels overwhelmed by what he's found. But he feels such a loss, such regret for the ones he threw away. That's the way God looks at us, all of us. He doesn't see the clay on the outside, the clay pot on the outside. He sees the treasure inside, the soul that he wants to seek and save, the soul he wants to restore as a relationship with God. He looks beyond the out and looks in. And that's the kind of eyes we have to see others with. Jesus saw this lady. He saw someone needing acceptance, a sense of value, needing encouragement, needing a new start. and he gives it to her. There's a story of a guy named Bill who lived in the States, and he was one of these college students with the long hair and holes in his jeans with an old t-shirt, and he never wore shoes or socks. And everybody on campus knew the guy was brilliant, but he lived his own way, and he dressed his own way. Well, then he ended up giving his life to Christ in university, and he decided that he better start attending church. So right across the street was a church that he decided he would attend first. And in this church, it was a very well-dressed, conservative church, traditional church. But he walks in anyway, and the church was pretty full. And I want to read you what happened when Bill walked in. The service had already started, and so Bill started down the aisle looking for a seat. The church was completely packed, and he couldn't find one. By now, people are looking a bit uncomfortable. This guy was wearing, you know, holy jeans and an ugly t-shirt and no shoes or socks. But when Bill realized there were no seats, he just squatted right down in the aisle on the carpet. By now, the people were getting really uptight, and the tension in the air was thick. And about this time, the minister realizes that from way at the back of the church, the deacon is slowly making his way toward Bill. Now, the deacon is in his 80s. He has silver gray hair, a three-piece suit, and a pocket watch. A godly man, very elegant, very dignified, very courtly, well-respected. He walked with a cane. And he started walking toward this boy. And everybody was saying to themselves, you can't blame him for what he's about to do. How can you expect a man of his age and of his background to understand some college kid squatting on the floor? It took a long time for the man to reach the boy. And the church was utterly silent, except for the clicking of the man's cane. All the eyes were focused on him. You couldn't hear anyone breathing. The people were thinking, the minister can't even preach until the sermon, until the deacon does what everybody knows he has to do. With great difficulty, he reached the man on the floor, dropped his cane, and lowered himself to sit next to Bill. And he began to worship so that Bill wouldn't be alone anymore. Everybody was choked up with emotion, and when the minister finally gained control, he said, what I'm about to preach, you will all forget. But what you have just seen, you will never, ever forget. That's the kind of church that I want to be a part of. That's the kind of church that Jesus wants us to be. The kind of church that reaches out and walks with those, comes alongside those who need us so badly to accompany them in their walk of faith, wherever they're at. And Jesus did that over and over again. He was patient with those who doubted, like Thomas. He reached out to those who were incapable of doing anything on their own, like the invalid who was trying to reach the healing pool called Bethesda for 38 years. He showed love to those who were rebellious, wasteful, and lost, like in the parable of the prodigal son. He accepted others despite their race or gender, like the woman at the well. She was female and a Samaritan, and yet Jesus took the time to reach out to her. The question is, do we have the heart of God so that we can see with the eyes of Christ? Take a look.
Broken sky, traced out by the city lights. My world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight. Touchdown in the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop. Breathing the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see.
everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 Step out on a busy street, see a girl and our eyes meet. Does her best to smile at me, to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right, black suit and a bright red tie. Too ashamed to tell his wife he's out of work, he's buying time. All those people going somewhere, why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 I've been there a million times, a couple million nights, just moving past me by. It's where I never thought that I was wrong. Well, I want a second glance, so give me a second chance to see the way you've seen the people all along. Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes, Lord, give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing.
We see with the heart of Christ. There's one more group of people that when I was getting ready to speak and praying about it, I really felt this was probably the toughest one for many of us. It's those people who have hurt us so badly. In Luke chapter 23, verse 32, it says, verse 33, it says this: when they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." When Jesus hung on the cross, he was able to look around, hanging there, suffocating. He looked around and saw those who hated him. He looked around and saw those who envied him. He saw those who were selfish and arrogant. He saw those who had accused him of wrong when he had done absolutely nothing wrong. He saw those who had taken him to Pilate to be executed. They wanted him destroyed. He saw those who had beat him and whipped him. He saw those who had spit on him and put the crown of thorns on his head. He saw those who had mocked and insulted and made fun of him. He saw those who had taken his clothes and divided them up. He saw those who had betrayed him. He saw those who, though they were his friends and his family, had done nothing despite being there with him. He looked at them all and he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not understand." Many of us have been hurt so badly in our lives, and the hardest people to look at with the heart of Christ are those people. The ones who have had the opportunity by doing something that have cut us deep. And Jesus saw those exact people who needed to experience God's love. He chose to let those past hurts go and offer them forgiveness. Maybe there are people in your life that you know you need to forgive. People in your life that you know you're not looking at with the eyes of Christ. Those people so close who have betrayed you. Those people so close who have lied to you. Those people so close who have hurt you and you have not offered up the forgiveness. Can you say, "Father, forgive them and help me forgive them too"? It's nice to be able to talk about all this, and it's nice to be able to say it, but it's another thing to do it. 1 John chapter 3, verse 16 to 18 says this: "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need and has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth." We are called not just to say we love and forgive, but we're actually called to act it out, to start seeing with the heart of Jesus and reaching out and making a difference in the people's lives around us. We're all in it together. But how many times do we look at that rebellious teenager, that homeless person, that drug addict or that prostitute, those out of work that we judge, those who live with us, those who live next door to us, those who work with us, those who have hurt us so bad? How many times do we jump to conclusions and think wrong thoughts about them without seeing them with the heart of God? He wants us to reach out in love, to restore relationships with people the same way he restored relationship with us. But maybe you are here today and you're actually on the other side of the fence. You do not understand how much God loves you. I want you to understand that you're loved by God no matter the amount of possessions you own, what you look like, what you think of yourself, what you've done in the past, the reputation you have, how many hurts you've experienced, or how many hurts you have caused. God loves you. God loves you, and he sent his son Jesus to die for you. We are all in this together. We all need to experience God's love. And we need to see ourselves the way Christ sees us. We need to experience forgiveness so that we are able to have eternal life based on faith. We must learn to walk with each other, sharing God's love and grace so that what we've experienced, we also give out. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." And that's the gift that we have to offer everyone we come across every single day. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for what we've experienced, the love and the forgiveness that you've already given us. Help us, Lord, to go into our workplace, into our homes, even in our churches, and to look at others the way you look at us, accepted and loved. And then help us to act upon that, Lord, so we can make the difference in other people that you've called us to make. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.